Good evening, this is Pamela, and you're listening to Watchmen on the Pod. We are going to continue part 10, Rome's Responsibility for the Assassination of Abraham Lincoln by Thomas M. Harris. In the book of the testimonies given in the prosecution of the assassin of Lincoln, published by Ben Pittman, and in the two volumes of the trial of John Surratt in 1867, we have the legal and irrefutable proof that the plot of the assassins of Lincoln was matured, if not started, in the house of Mary Surratt, number 561 H Street, Washington City, D.C. But who were living in that house and who were visiting that family? The legal answer says the most devoted Catholics in the city. The sworn testimonies show more than that. They show that it was the common rendezvous of the priests of Washington. Several priests swear that they were going there sometimes, and when pressed to answer what they meant by sometimes, they were not sure if it was not once a week or once a month. One of them, less on his guard, swore that he seldom passed before that house without entering, and he said he never passed less than once a week. The devoted Roman Catholic and apostate from Protestantism, called L. J. Wickman, who was himself living in that house, swears that Father Wiggett was very often in that house, and Father Lehman swears that he was living with Mrs. Surratt in the same house. What does the presence of so many priests in that house reveal to the world? No man of common sense who knows anything about the priests of Rome can entertain any doubt that not only they knew all that was going on inside those walls, but that they were the advisors, the counselors, the very soul of that infernal plot. Why did Rome keep one of her priests under that roof from morning till night and from night till morning? Why did she send many others almost every day of the week into that dark nest of plotters against the very existence of the great republic and against the life of her own president? Her principal generals and leading men, if it were not to be the advisors, the rulers, the secret motive power of the infernal plot. No one, if he is not an idiot, will think and say that those priests who were the personal friends and father confessors of Booth, John Surratt, Mrs. and Mrs., so it's a Mrs. M-R-S and then Mrs. M-I-S-S-E-S-S, Surratt, could be constantly there without knowing what was going on, particularly when we know that every one of those priests was a rapid rebel in heart. Every one of those priests, knowing that his infallible Pope had called Jeff Davies his dear son and had taken the Southern Confederacy under his protection, was bound to believe that the most holy thing a man could do was to fight for the Southern cause by destroying those who were its enemies. Read the history of the assassination of Admiral Coligny, Henry III and Henry IV, and William the Taciturn by the hired assassins of the Jesuits. Compare them with the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and you will find that one resembles the other as one drop of water resembles another. You will understand that they all come from the same source, Rome. In all those murders, you will find that the murderers, selected and trained by the Jesuits, were of the most exalted Roman Catholic piety, living in the company of priests, going to confess very often, receiving the communion the day before, if not the very day of the murder. You will see in all those horrible deeds of hell prepared behind the dark walls of the Holy Inquisition that the assassins were considering themselves as the chosen instruments of God to save the nations by striking its tyrant, that they firmly believed that there was no sin in killing the enemy of the people, of the Holy Church, and of the infallible Pope. Compare the last hours of the Jesuit, let's see if I can say his name, Ravaillac, the assassin of Henry IV, who absolutely refused to repent, though suffering the most horrible torture on the rack with Booth, who, suffering also the most horrible tortures from his broken leg, writes in his daily memorandum the very day before his death, "I can never repent, though we hated to kill. Our country owed all her troubles to him, Lincoln, and God simply made me the instrument of his punishment." Yes, compare the bloody deeds of those two assassins, and you will see that they had been trained in the same school. They had been taught by the same teachers. Evidently, the Jesuit Ravaillac calling all the saints of heaven to his help at his last hour, and Booth, pressing the medal of the Virgin Mary on his breast, with failing mortally, was falling, I'm sorry, when falling mortally wounded, are both coming out of the same Jesuit mold. Who has lost his common sense enough to suppose that it was Jeff Davies who had filled the mind and the heart of Booth with that religious and so exalted fanaticism? Surely Jeff Davies could have promised the money to reward the assassins and nerve their arms by the hope of becoming rich. The testimonies on that account say that $1 million had been asked from him. The Ark Rebel could give the money, but the Jesuits alone could select the assassins, train them, and show them a crown of glory in heaven if they would kill the author of the bloodshed, the famous renegade and apostate, the enemy of the Pope and of the Church, Lincoln. Who does not see the lessons given by the Jesuits to Booth in their daily intercourse in Mary Surratt's house when he reads those lines written by Booth a few hours before his death? I can never repent. God may be the instrument of his punishment. Compare these words with the doctrines and principles taught by the council, the decrees of the Pope, and the laws of the Holy Inquisition, as you find them in chapter 55 of this volume, and you will find that the sentiments and belief of Booth flow from those principles as the river flows from its source. And that pious Miss Surratt, M-I-S-S, who the very next day after the murder of Lincoln said, without being rebuked in the presence of several witnesses, "The death of Abraham Lincoln is no more than the death of a nigger in the army." Whoa, are you serious? I remember reading that, but that just is right there. I'm sorry. Here we go. Where did she get that maximum, if not from her church? Had not that church recently proclaimed through her highest legal and civil authority, the devoted Roman Catholic Judge Taney, in his Dred Scott decision, that Negroes have no right which the white is bound to respect? By bringing the president on a level with the lowest N-word, Rome was saying that he had no right even to his life, for this was the maximum of the rebel priests who everywhere had made themselves the echoes of the sentence of their distinguished co-religionist, Taney. It was from the very lips of the priests who were constantly coming in and going out of their house that those young ladies had learned those anti-social and anti-Christian doctrines. Read in the testimony concerning Mrs. Mary E. Surratt how the Jesuits had perfectly drilled her in the art of perjuring herself. In the very moment when the government officer orders her to prepare herself with her daughter to follow him as prisoner, at about 10 p.m., Payne, the would-be murderer of Seward, knocks at the door and wants to see Mrs. Surratt. But instead of having Mrs. Surratt to open the door, he finds himself confronted face to face with the government detective, Major Smith, who swears, "I question him in regard to his occupation and what business he had at the house at this late hour of the night. He stated that he was a laborer and had come to dig a gutter at the request of Mrs. Surratt. I went to the parlor door and said, 'Mrs. Surratt, will you step here a minute?' She came out and I asked her, 'Do you know this man? And did you hire him to come and dig a gutter for you?' She answered, raising her right hand, 'Before God, sir, I do not know this man. I have never seen him and did not hire him to dig a gutter for me.' But it was proved after by several unimpeachable witnesses that she knew very well that Payne was a personal friend of her son, who many times had come to her house in company of his friend and pet, Booth. She had received the communion just 2 or 3 days before that public perjury. Just a moment after taking it, the officer ordered her to step out into the carriage, but before doing it, she asked permission to kneel down and pray, which was granted. I asked if from any man of common sense could Jeff Davies have imparted such a religious calm and self-possession to that woman when her hands were just reddened with the blood of the president and she was on her way to trial? No, with sang-froid, such calm in that soul in such a terrible and solemn hour could only from the teachings of those Jesuit for more than 6 months were in her house, showing her a crown of eternal glory if she could help to kill the monster apostate Lincoln, the only cause of that horrible civil war. There is not the least doubt that the priest had perfectly succeeded in persuading Mary Seward and Booth that the killing of Lincoln was a most holy and deserving work for which God had eternal reward in store." Wow. There is a fact to which the American people have not yet given a sufficient attention. It is that, without a single exception, the conspirators were Roman Catholics. The learned and great patriot, General Baker, in his admirable report, struck and bewildered by that strange, mysterious, and portentous fact, said, "I mention as an exceptional and remarkable fact that every conspirator in custody is by education a Catholic." But those words, which, if well understood by the United States, would have thrown so much light on the true causes of their untold and unspeakable disasters, fell as if on the ears of deaf men. Very few, if any, paid attention to them. As General Baker says, all the conspirators were attending Catholic church services and were educated Roman Catholics. It is true that some of them, as Esteroth, Payne, and Harold, asked for Protestant ministers when they were to be hung, but they had been considered till then as converts to Romanism. At page 437 of the trial of John Surratt, Louis Wickman tells us that he was going to St. Alison's Church with Esteroth, and that it was there that he introduced him to Mr. Brody, another Roman Catholic. It is a well-authenticated fact that Booth and Wickman, who were themselves Protestant perverts to Romanism, had proselytized a good number of semi-Protestants and infidels who, either from conviction or from hope of the fortunes promised the successful murderers, were themselves very zealous for the Church of Rome. Payne, Esteroth, and Harold were among those proselytes, and when those murderers were to appear before the country and receive the just punishment of their crime, the Jesuits were too shrewd to ignore that if they were all coming on the scaffold of Roman Catholics and accompanied by their father confessors, it would at once open the eyes of the American people and clearly show that this was a Roman Catholic plot. They persuaded three of their proselytes to avail themselves of the theological principles of the Church of Rome, that a man is allowed to conceal his religion, nay, that he may say that he is a heretic, a Protestant, though he is a Roman Catholic, when it is for his own interest or the best interest of his church to conceal the truth and deceive the people. Here is the doctrine of Rome on that subject. Sapis milis est ad Deo honorum et utilitatem. Proximity, I can't say all those words. Anyway, this is the interpretation or the translation. It is often more to the glory of God and the good of our neighbor to cover the faith than to confess it. For example, if concealed among heretics, you may accomplish a greater amount of good of if by declaring our religion more of an evil would follow, for example, great trouble, death, and hostility of a tyrant. Wow. Wow. It is evident that the Jesuits had never had better reasons to suspect that the declaration of their religion would damage them and excite the wrath of their tyrant, the American people. Lloyd's, in whose house Mrs. Surratt concealed the carbine which Booth wanted for protection, when just after the murder he was to flee towards the southern states, was a firm Roman Catholic. Dr. Mudd, at whose place Booth stopped to have his broken leg dressed, was a Roman Catholic. And so was Garrett, in whose barn Booth was caught and killed. Why so? Because as Jeff Davies was the only man to pay $1 million to those who would kill Abraham Lincoln, the Jesuits were the only men to select the murderers and prepare everything to protect them after their diabolical deed. And such murderers could not be found except among their blind and fanatical slaves. The fatal mistake of the American government in the prosecution of the assassins of Abraham Lincoln was to constantly keep out of sight the religious element of that terrible drama. Nothing could have been more easy than to find out the complicity of the priests who were not only coming every week and every day, but who were even living in that den of murderers. But this was carefully avoided from the beginning to the end of the trial. When, not long after the execution of the murderers, I went incognito to Washington to begin my investigation about its true and real authors, I was not a little surprised to see that not a single one of the government men to whom I addressed myself would consent to have any talk with me on that matter, except after I had given my word of honor that I would never mention their names in connection with the result of my investigation. I saw with a profound distress that the influence of Rome was almost supreme in Washington. I could not find a single statesman who would dare to face that nefarious influence and fight it down. Several of the government men in whom I had more confidence told me we had not the least doubt that the Jesuits were at the bottom of that great iniquity. We even feared sometimes that this would come out so clearly before the military tribunal that there would be no possibility of keeping it out of the public sight. This was not through cowardice, as you think, but through a wisdom which you ought to approve, if you cannot admire it. Had we been in days of peace, we know that with a little more pressure on the witnesses, many priests would have been compromised, for Mrs. Surratt's house was their common rendezvous. It is more than probable that several of them might have been hung, but the Civil War was hardly over. The Confederacy, though broken down, was still living in millions of hearts. Murderers and formidable elements of discord were still seen everywhere, to which the hanging or exiling of those priests would have given a new life. Riots after riots would have accompanied and followed their execution. We thought we had enough of blood, fires, devastations, and bad feelings. We were all longing after days of peace. The country was in need of them. We concluded that the best interest of humanity was to punish only those who were publicly and visibly guilty, that the verdict might receive the approbation of all without creating any new bad feelings. Allow us also to tell you that this policy was that of our late president, for you know it well. There was nothing which that good and great man feared so much as to arm the Protestants against the Catholics and the Catholics against the Protestants. But if anyone has still any doubts of the complicity of the Jesuits in the murder of Abraham Lincoln, let him give a moment of attention to the following facts, and their doubts will be forever removed. It is only from the very Jesuit accomplice's lips that I take my sworn testimonies. Let's see what time. We're good. It is evident that a very elaborate plan of escape had been prepared by the priest of Rome to save the lives of the assassins and the conspirators. It would be too long to follow all the murderers when, Cain-like, they were fleeing in every direction to escape the vengeance of God and man. Let us fix our eyes on John Surratt, who was in Washington the 14th of April helping Booth in the perpetration of the assassination. Who will take care of him? Who will protect and conceal him? Who will press him on their bosom, put their mantles on his shoulders to conceal him from the just vengeance of the human and divine laws? The priest, Charles Bocar, swears that only a few days after the murder, John Surratt was sent to him by Father Lapeer of Montreal, that he kept him concealed in his parsonage of St. Liborie from the end of April to the end of July. Then he took him back secretly to Father Lapeer, who kept him secreted in his own father's house under the very shadow of the Montreal bishop's palace. He swears that Father Lapeer visited him, Surratt, often when secreted at St. Liborie, and that he, Father Bocar, visited him at least twice a week from the end of July to September when concealed in Father Lapeer's house in Montreal. That same father, Charles Bocar, swears that he accompanied John Surratt in a carriage in the company of Father Lapeer in the steamer Montreal when starting for Quebec. That Father Lapeer kept him, John Surratt, under lock during the voyage from Montreal to Quebec, and that he accompanied him disguised from the Montreal steamer to the ocean steamer Puravan. The doctor of the steamer Puravan, L.I.A. McMillan, swears that Father Lapeer introduced him to John Surratt under the false name of McCarthy, whom he was keeping locked into his stateroom and whom he conducted disguised to the ocean steamer Puravan, and with whom he remained till she left Quebec for Europe the 15th September 1865. But who is that Father Lapeer who takes such a tender and, dare I say, a paternal care of Surratt? It is not less a personage than the canon of Bishop Burgett. Really? That's right. He was mean. All right, Bishop Burgett of Montreal. He is the confidential man of the bishop. He lives with the bishop, eats at his table, assists him with his counsel, and has to receive his advice in every step of life. According to the laws of Rome, the canons are to the bishop that the arms are to the body. Now I ask, is it not evident that the bishops and the priests of Washington have trusted this murderer to the care of the bishops and the priests of Montreal, that they might conceal, feed, and protect him for nearly 6 months under the very shadow of the bishop's palace? Would they have done that if they were not his accomplices? Why did they so continually remain with him day and night if they were not in fear that he might compromise them by an indiscreet word? Why do we see those priests, I ought to say, those ambassadors and anointed representatives of the Pope, alone in the carriage which takes that great culprit from his house of concealment to the steamer? Why do they keep him there under lock till they transfer him under a disguised name to the ocean steamer, the Preveyron, on the 15th July, 1865? Why such tender sympathies for that stranger? Why going through such trouble and expense for that young American among the bishops and priests of Canada? There is only one answer. He was one of their tools, one of their selected men to strike the great republic of equality and liberty to the heart. For more than 6 months before the murder, the priest had lodged, eaten, conversed, slept with him under the same roof in Washington. They had trained him to his deed of blood by promising him protection on earth and a crown of glory in heaven, if he would only be true to their designs to the end. And he had been true to the end. Now the great crime is accomplished. Lincoln is murdered. Jeff Davies, the dear son of the Pope, is avenged. The great republic has been struck to the heart. The soldiers of liberty all over the world are weeping over the dead form of the one who had led them to victory. A cry of desolation goes from earth to heaven. It seems as if we heard the death knell of the cause of freedom, equality, fraternity among men. It was many centuries since the implacable enemies of the rights and liberties of men had struck such a giant foe. Their joy was as great as their victory complete. But do you see that man fleeing from Washington towards the north? He has the mark of Cain on his forehead. His hands are reddened with blood. He is pale and trembling, for he knows it. A whole outraged nation is after him for her just vengeance. He hears the thundering voice of God. Where is thy brother? Where will he find a refuge? Where, outside of hell, will he meet friends to shelter and save him from the just vengeance of God and men? Oh, he has sure refuge in the arms of that church who for more than 1,000 years is crying, death to all the heretics, death to all the soldiers of liberty. He has devoted friends among the very men who, after having prepared the massacre of Admiral Coligny and his 75,000 Protestant countrymen, rang the bells of Rome to express their joy when they heard that, at last, the King of France had slaughtered them all. But where will those bishops and priests of Canada send John Surratt when they find it impossible to conceal him any longer from the thousands of detectives of the United States who are ransacking Canada to find out his retreat? Who will conceal, feed, lodge, and protect him after the priest of Canada pressed his hand for the first time on board of the Preveyron the 15th of September, 1865? Who can have any doubt about that? Who can suppose that any one but the Pope himself and his Jesuits will protect the murderer of Abraham Lincoln in Europe? If you want to see him after he has crossed the ocean, go to Verdi, the door of Rome, and there you will find him enrolled under the banners of the Pope in the ninth company of his Zouaves, under the false name of Watson. Of course, the Pope was forced to withdraw his protection over him after the government of the United States had found him there, and he was brought back to Washington to be tried. But on his arrival as a prisoner in the United States, his Jesuit father confessor whispered in his ear, "Fear not, you will not be condemned. Through the influence of a high Roman Catholic lady, two or three of the jurymen will be Roman Catholics, and you will be safe." Those who have read the two volumes of the trial of John Surratt know that never more evident proofs of guilt were brought against a murderer than in that case. But the Roman Catholic jurymen, had read the Theology of St. Thomas, a book which the Pope has ordered to be taught in every college, academy, and university of Rome. They had learned that it is the duty of the Roman Catholics to exterminate all heretics. They had read the decree of the Councils of Constantine that no faith was to be kept with heretics. They had read in the Council of Latrine that the Catholics who arm themselves for the extermination of heretics have all their sins forgiven and receive the same blessings as those who go and fight for the rescue of the Holy Land. Those jurymen were told by their father confessors that the Most Holy Father, the Pope Gregory VII, had solemnly and infallibly declared the killing of an heretic was no murder. After such teachings, how could the Roman Catholic jurymen find John Surratt guilty of murder for killing the heretic Lincoln? The jury, having disagreed, no verdict could be given. The government was forced to let the murderer go unpunished. But when the irreconcilable enemies of all the rights and liberties of men were congratulating themselves on the successful efforts to save the life of John Surratt, the God of heaven was stamping again on their faces the mark of murder in such a way that all eyes will see it. Editor's note, the previous paragraph introduces an account of the conversation that F.A. Conwell had with a purveyor of a Jesuit seminary in the predominantly Roman Catholic village of St. Joseph, Minnesota, who told Conwell that Abraham Lincoln had been assassinated hours before the assassination happened. The event is described in General Harris's book, and so it will not be repeated here. Wow. Next time I will pick up and I will finish the book, because the next part is the afterword, and that will just be too long to tack onto this. All right, brothers and sisters, I love you so very, very much. That's the history. The man was there. We were not. He was there, eyewitness, seen it all. All right, keep your eyes on Jesus, brothers and sisters. Your nose in the book, which is the Word of God. And embed the Word of God upon the tablets of your hearts, so you will not sin against God or be deceived. I love you all so very much. Bye-bye.